You've written many books, and I know you're familiar with the tech industry and the Bay Area. You've lived here for a very long time. So I assume you had some sort of assumptions when you walked into this, but I'm wondering if, as you were on your reporting journey, you found out things that just surprised you.
Actually, the whole thing surprised me. So I had come out of my last book, How to Make a Spaceship. You referenced Elon Musk, and that was very male-dominated, the last two books. And so this was surprising to me because you hear so much negativity about, and it exists, it's real in Silicon Valley. But I found these really astounding women who had succeeded, and I wanted to know how they did it and what the world there looks like for them, going after deals, sitting at the table, meeting with entrepreneurs, going out for funding. And it surprised me how strategic they were in their success and how it is possible to kind of increment your way to success as they did, navigating before they could pioneer. So I was really wowed by that, by these stories. The stories of Alpha Girls are very personal. So it's personal lives, it's professional lives, it's how women juggle all that we do. You're nodding your head. Mm-hmm. So the whole thing surprised me, how women succeed, what the terrain is like, what the outcomes are, and that there are these really important success stories, notably Teresa right mm-hmm. here, and how they did it, and just their backstories. Yeah. I found so inspiring.
And I'm so glad you did. And Teresa, I mean, I learned things that I, you know, didn't know about you, and I feel like I've interviewed you and talked to you about this many times.
We've been friends for a long time.
But obviously you worked at a male-dominated venture capital firm, Excel. You went on to start your own new venture capital firm. And I'm curious, what sort of strategizing you did along the way, the times where you knew you were the only woman going into a room and did something intentionally because of that?
You know, I think that there's, I would say the biggest thing is being aware of that, and I think actually Magdalena says it really well in the book, to tip my hat to one of the other Alpha Girls, is sometimes you need to think about that as a strategic advantage. So like early in my career, I would realize if I was going to some big tech conference that it was actually potentially a positive. So if I'm, you know, if everybody's inundating these same entrepreneurs, if I can actually say something smart about their business, the chance that they're going to remember me instead of somebody else named Joe or Bob or Jim is higher. So viewing it as a positive instead of always viewing it as a negative, viewing it as an opportunity.
So, Julian, obviously there are many, many women who could have probably succeeded in Silicon Valley if the playing field was more level, and we hope there are many more Teresas to come. But what do you think it was about the women that you highlighted that enabled them to succeed in an area that was so male-dominated?
That's a great question. I think it was what Teresa touched on, was looking past possible slights and possible barriers, or very real ones, and kind of looking beyond that and maneuvering beyond those things. So having a sense of humor was always super helpful. Mm. Being really optimistic, finding an area of specialty like Teresa did in cybersecurity, being very quantitative, really knowing your stuff, working harder than just about any guy in the room. So those were some of the commonalities that they had. And they love the industry too. You know, they love tech, they love venture capital, they love being a part of this, that dynamic ecosystem that is Silicon Valley. So in those ways, you know, they had optimism and they had perseverance, of course.
Now, Teresa, you're now part of this sort of new movement. You and your partner, Jennifer Fonseca, have gone off to start a new venture capital firm. Melinda Gates has invested in your firm. There are organizations like AllRaise, which are women from competing venture capital firms who have gotten together to try to improve the representation of women in investing, women in entrepreneurship. Do you feel the change happening, or do you still feel like we're stuck in the past?
No. So first I would start with, I've always felt like there's always been sort of, it's been more secret underground sisterhood here in tech, right? I mean, kind of going back to some of the, honestly, tipping a hat to our, like the early pioneering days of the events that Sheryl would host at her mm-hmm. house, where in the beginning, Sheryl Sandberg, sorry, and in the beginning, me and I know many other people, we would just not put exactly what we're doing on, just for like dinner, right? But then it kind of was like, and it was super helpful for us. But now it's like not only like out in the open, it's like, you know, the the male entrepreneurs see it also as an advantage, right? The fact that we have this different network for recruiting, for deal sourcing. And so I think it can be, it's wonderful to see it be so public and out there. And the last thing I would say, those are all great groups. We wouldn't be anywhere without our male allies, and Julian writes about them in the book. Mm-hmm. But I also think that Julian's book, it's about a lot of venture capitalists, four venture capitalists who happen to be female. But it's really, to me, she wrote a book that's really a story about four people who are from outside Silicon mm-hmm. Valley, who came in, had no proven path, and just found their own way. And hopefully that will appeal to a broad range of entrepreneurs and people whose dreams potentially lie here in Silicon Valley.
Now, in the middle of my own reporting process when I was writing my book, which is also about women in tech, the momentum changed and people started talking about this. The Me Too movement happened and I was in the middle of writing and everything exploded and I had to, you know, do a bunch more interviews and call a lot of people. How did that change your reporting process? I'm curious. The fact that this conversation sort of, maybe it was underground before, but it sort of exploded out into the open.
So I had thought that it would make the women less reticent, mm-hmm. more willing to speak out, maybe about injustices and wrongs. But with this book, I found that was the most challenging thing, because these women have succeeded by, to a certain extent, being unflappable mm-hmm. and expecting perfectionism, certainly among themselves. But to show their vulnerabilities was very difficult. I think it's hard. You know, they worked so hard to get where they did, and it was not easy, and I write about those things in the book. So it was still something where they had to exceed expectations. It was hard. It was hard for them to be vulnerable, even post Me Too.
Yeah.
So that was another surprise for me.
So Teresa, you've been investing now for a very long time. I'm so curious for an update on aspects. What you think is hot, you know, I want to hear your investing thesis. I want to hear from you where you think the puck is going.
Sure. So, well, I don't know if this is where it's going. It's been for a while. As you know, as Julian mentioned, I've been doing cybersecurity investing mm-hmm. since 99, 2000. So when it was this like small little backwater, and been fortunate to have a couple of those companies like Forescout and others, which is from mm-hmm. our Aspect Fund, go public. So that continues to be a big area of investment and interest. There's also quite a lot of activity. I'm sure everyone talks about it in terms of, you know, AI and machine learning, but in some very specific places that I think are really interesting. We do quite a few things in the fintech space that use that. So companies like Chime and Deserve are also in our portfolio, in addition to Forescout and Exabeam, which are using machine learning and cybersecurity. And we're starting to see some really interesting applications of machine learning, potentially in digital health. So more to stay tuned. But fintech and cybersecurity, the really boring stuff where a lot of the money is, continues to be a hot area.
So what's your outlook on the recent IPOs and upcoming IPOs? Uber this week, having just seen Lyft, Pinterest, Zoom.
Look, I think all of those companies are doing quite well, and I think we have more Slack and others, right, in the mm-hmm. pipeline. I think this is going to continue to be a really good time for growth tech IPOs throughout the rest of this year.
And is it impacting your investing strategy at all?
It doesn't impact us because we invest at the really early stage, at the Series A stage. So these are companies that are, you know, 5, 10, 15 years after that investment time frame. But what it does say is for those of our companies that are further along, it does show them that, you know, the market is open now. Just like with Trulia, we had Pete earlier on, that was Series A, but yeah. You know, 5 years later, they're, you know, in a later stage. So it's really impacting those companies from 4 or 5 years ago, not so much the new investments.
All right.